Apparently, from what Ramatlhodi told the commission today, Aaron, the Guptas would brag about the hold that they had on the former president.
Yes, and of course the testimony of Ramatlhodi at this point is entirely unchallenged because the former president and his son have not put up versions to dispute what's in the statement, both written and now oral, from Ramatlhodi. And he used that very vivid image of how he described the stronghold, he said, this family had on the then president. Let's have a look.
The president has got two secretaries. One belongs to the Guptas, the other is in Matlamandlo or Union Buildings.
Mm.
Now, so they can easily interfere with his diary if they want him.
Mm.
They insist you come and then he come running there.
Mm.
Now, we're asking ourselves, what is this thing, that this hold that they have on him, over him?
Mm.
We couldn't understand the grip.
Mm.
You know, you know, it's like a python, you know, and when a python wraps itself around you, unless somebody takes out the tail from the soil, you are finished.
Mm.
So because it has got a horn at the back there, which gives it a balance.
Mm.
Now, it was just like that. It was like a python which had wrapped itself around him.
Did he at the very least attempt to provide answers to his own question as to what it was, you know, that the Guptas had, allegedly had on the former president?
Well, what he did do was open the curtain, as it were, on ANC-NEC meetings. And there was a lot of back and forth between him and Deputy Chief Justice Raymond Zondo on why the NEC wasn't able to bring the then president into line or try and break this relationship or unravel, as it were, that python, that stronghold that the Guptas seemed to have on the then president. And Ramatlhodi there said that there was the issue of factions. He alleges that Zuma was the head of a faction of NEC members who were themselves associated with the Guptas, and by virtue of that faction existing, it then factionalized other aspects or other parties in the NEC, and so there was a real power play, a tussle, a tug of war between different aspects or elements, factions of the NEC, and that's what meant that Zuma and the Guptas were then able, on his allegations and his claims, able to capture the state. I mean, the testimony we had today, Vuyo, really has been the most astounding, shocking testimony, putting the then president front and center of allegations of state capture that we've heard so far. And not soon afterwards, Ramatlhodi names the former president's son, Duduzane Zuma, and the Gupta family.
But did he get to the bottom, or at least try to explain why their scales were tipped in the Zuma faction, so to speak? Did he give an explanation?
He did, in a way, and Zondo pressed him on that, and he said that these were people who themselves were sort of bowing to Gupta pressure, that these were people who were, on some occasion, self-proclaimed Gupta ministers. And he also answered a question posed by this analogy of the python with its grip around the then president, in saying that Zuma himself said in an NEC meeting that this family had been good to him, that his friends in the form of the Guptas had been helpful when Zuma was persona non grata, and had not only been helpful to Zuma, the head of state and head of the governing party, but also to his sons. And on Ramatlhodi's allegations and Ramatlhodi's claims, which are unchallenged at this point by any of the Zumas, he said that, you know, Zuma named his two sons. He named Duduzane and he named Edward, and said the Guptas have helped these sons of mine. And Ramatlhodi says Zuma simply would not budge on breaking up that friendship.
Did he? I mean, he eventually, of course, got to the part where he spoke about the last days of former President Jacob Zuma in power, how at that time they then managed, you know, to get him where they really wanted him. Did he give any sort of explanations as to what they did or they were able to do at that point, that which they weren't able to do in all the years that he was allegedly in the pockets of the Guptas?
not in much detail. If you're wanting the inner machinations of the governing party and who moved from which faction to which other faction, he didn't give us those details. He said there was a shift in power, and Zondo quite rightly observed that it seems that when there was a shift in leadership in the governing party from Zuma to Ramaphosa and Nasrak, which Ramatlhodi himself referred to, that's when things finally shifted. What was behind that shift and motivated people to move from one sympathy to another? We don't have any details on that at this point. But what we do know from Ramatlhodi's testimony today is that he has no doubt that Zuma and the Guptas are culpable on his allegations for state capture.
Now, Ramatlhodi's former advisor was also had a lot, lots and lots to reveal that gave some insights into how former President Jacob Zuma operated and the kinds of people that he wanted on board, presumably to facilitate state capture.
Yes, and with more of her, we actually had some interrogation from Zondo on how he agreed to go to meetings, for example, with Nathi Nhleko, then police minister in Cape Town, and some confusion over what exactly the meeting was about. The advocate who was the advisor to Ramatlhodi saying that when he left for that meeting, he understood he was being hailed in his capacity on a committee looking into Nkandla, but when he arrived, he was then told that he'd been earmarked as a potential candidate to be the National Director of Public Prosecutions. And Zondo really pressing him there and needling him there to say, well, what was your response to that? And he said he was shocked, but he was also flattered that his work had been deemed to be so good that he would be earmarked for a position such as that of NDPP. And with his testimony as well, we got a very clear, well, clear is maybe not the right adjective, Vuyo, but we got a very telling sense of the blurred lines between governing party and state when this advocate described his decisions around agreeing to be on that committee in the first place, saying when Nhleko called him and invited him to be on the committee, well, this was a senior person in the ANC, and you don't question that sort of thing. And Zondo saying, but this was not something to do with the ANC. This was to do with government. And he said, yes, but it's tradition within the party that when you get called in that fashion by someone senior, that you don't question it. And so it might have been something some people missed watching the testimony, but it gives you a very clear sense of the sort of confusion that happens with people serving in national government who are also loyal cadres of the governing party.
Would you say that perhaps it again brings home an argument that some people have been making all along, that when you look at the people who have come before the commission so far, it would actually be a mistake or wrong to look at these people as being, you know, saints and sinners?
I think very much so. I think the idea of good and bad is so misplaced.
Well, he was a guy who couldn't make a distinction between party and state.
Yes, but and we also have to be careful of saying that to the point where no one's accountable for their decisions and collective responsibility really letting people off the hook for the choices they made and the meetings they may have agreed to go to with the Guptas. But certainly there is that aspect of angels with horns and devils with wings, and we've seen that at the inquiry.
Aaron Bates, that's where we're going to leave it. Thanks very much for coming through. She was, of course, at the state capture inquiry today.